strong, like he knows what he's talking about. He's very intelligent, but he's very legalistic. Very legalistic. And because he has that, he just tells me how it is. Well, how what is? Amen? But see, people are duped by that. Now jump to verse 8. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy. Beware lest any demon spoil you. Any man. Through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, and after the rudiments, or the way the world does things, after the rudiments of the world and not after Christ. How does the world do things? The world's whole system is based upon you. Now, no employer hires somebody based on just on grace. If you want to show up, fine. If you don't, that's fine too. It doesn't work that way. The whole world, and nor should it. In this system, it doesn't work that way. You don't hire somebody, and if they don't perform, you will have to let them go. You know what I'm saying? You can't operate that. But see, God relates based on Jesus. Now, once again, we need to understand works. We need to understand our part, which is responding to the fact that God's done everything. We'll get there, maybe. But he's saying, beware lest any man spoil, literally take you captive through philosophy and vain deceit. Vain deceit after tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, not after Christ. I was thinking about Kerry Livgren, the guy in Kansas, his song, Dust in the Wind. Many of you have heard that song. And there's a line in there that says, all we do crumbles to the ground, though we refuse to see. That is an amazing line. All we do. That's the book of Ecclesiastes. All we do outside of Christ. And I've been meditating on Hebrews chapter 4, verse 10, where it says, for he that has entered into God's rest, he's also ceased from his own works as God did from his. It didn't say he ceased from works. He ceased from his own works. There's a difference. Amen? I work in the body of Christ. I labor in the Word of God and doctrine, but I don't labor in my own strength. Where's my trust? That's the point. When I do things, is my trust in him or is my trust in me? Is it in my greatness, what I think is my greatness, which is not is nil, or is it in him? Are you hearing that? And see, and that's the plight of mankind. We do so many things, and it crumbles to it's nothing if it's not in line with God's word. I honestly believe, and I believe the Lord's been showing me this, I think I'm finally getting to the end of me. That's the beginning of God. Are you hearing me? I'm not as great as I used to think I was, despite my athleticism. That's a joke. Amen? But see, we all have that. And when you understand that it's Christ, that you know why I believe God wants to use me and you to touch the world? You know why? Because Christ lives in me. The Bible says we have this treasure, 2 Corinthians 4, 7. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. Earthen vessels literally means cheap clay pottery. Wow. What is that treasure? Christ in me, the hope of glory, the temple of the Holy Ghost. That's what I have in an earthen vessel. See, the more I see that, it isn't about me, it's about him. That's what makes it such good news. But see, most of the church is preaching, you do this and God will do this. Wrong. God's already done everything. If you believe it, respond. Faith is nothing more than a response to the love of God. Amen. I don't do things for my wife to get her to marry me. She's already done it. But see, we do that. The church teaches that. That's the spirit of Antichrist. That's what that is. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit after the tradition of men. In other words, after the way man does things, after the rudiments of the world, the way the world does things, and not after Christ. Now look at verse 16. This is amazing. One little chapter, 23 verses, four times. Let no man. And notice it says you don't do it. Well, God will just do it. You know, people say stuff like, these sounds really humble, but it's really ignorant. Well, if God wants it to be, it'll be. God's not willing that any perish, but all come to repentance, but multitudes do. Amen. Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day or the new moon or the Sabbath days. Next verse. Which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is Christ. In other words, those things were just mere shadows or types or pictures. They were not the substance. All right, one more verse, verse 18. There it is again. Let no devil. See, I think it's amazing that the devil is so defeated and so whipped. Like I said, I think I said it Thursday night. The reason people preach sin and the devil's big is because they preach Jesus small. The bigger you preach Jesus, the smaller you preach sin and the devil. It's like a water balloon. You squeeze one end, the other end gets bigger. You squeeze this end, that end gets bigger. But I'm very leery when I hear people, the devil this and the devil this and the devil that. I told you, I heard a story. One man said, he said, you know, he got up there, this guitar out of tune, and I need you all to pray for me. I'm going to sing a little bit. I'm just going to try. The devil's been fighting me. He said, I leaned over to my friends and said, I'm with the devil on this one because I've heard him sing. Yeah. Let no man beguile you of your reward. You mean we can be beguiled? He's talking to Christians. There's rewards. God rewards the diligent seeker. Not the couch potato leaker. That worked. God rewards the diligent seeker because that's faith. Faith has action. Faith manifests. Once again, the building's on fire. I believe you. And you don't move? You don't believe me. Or else you have an extremely low IQ. And I know better than that. Let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind. Well, that's a danger. Let's just finish this chapter because it gets really good. And not holding the head. In other words, you can be as a believer not holding fast to the head, which is Christ. Isn't that amazing? Satan loves the pulpit. He loves it. He does his greatest work here. You know, I was sitting there thinking about this morning. You know, why would the devil could care less about those out in the world? They're already deceived. The only ones he cares about is you, and he can't do nothing, so he's got to find people to preach his doctrine, which is the spirit of Antichrist. But half the church thinks they're buying survival kits because they think they're going to press drop the big one. Amen? Talk about deception. That's a master stroke. And not holding the head, talking to believers, from which all the body... By joints, say all the body. By joints and bands having nourishment ministered and knit together, increaseth with the increase of God, or increases with the increase that comes from God. You know, there's an increase called growth that comes from God. You know, in the book of 2 Peter, it talks about growing in grace. They think, oh, I got it. Really? I've said it many times. You don't get it, you just keep getting it. That's a sign that you got it. You think you know anything, you know nothing as you ought. Didn't say you didn't know anything, says you don't know it as you ought. I tell people, I told a guy last night, I said, the greatest danger to our growth is what I think I know. My brother, you ain't telling me, I already know that. Dangerous. Dangerous. Puffed up by my fleshly mind. Amen. And not holding the head, from which all the body by joints and bands, having nourishment ministered and knit together, increases with the increase from God, that comes from God. Next verse. Wherefore, if you be dead with Christ, if you're born again, the Bible says you've already died with Christ in the eyes of God. Now, physically, you will shed these bodies. The world will call that death. But God says he's already abolished death. He's already taken care of that. And in his, for us, it's just a crossing over. So if you be dead with Christ, if you're born again from the rudiments of the world or the world's way of doing things, why? Look at your neighbor and say, why? 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 He's talking to believers. Why, as though living in the world, are you subject to ordinances? Do you subject yourself to these things to somehow try to earn something from God? Next verse. What are these ordinances? Here they are. Touch not, taste not, handle not. This is what he's talking about. Why do you subject yourself, which are all to perish with the using, after the commandments and doctrines of men? Next verse. Which things indeed have a show of wisdom. In will worship, isn't that amazing terminology? Will worship. We worship our will, our ability. Where there's a will, there's a way, brother. I'm just going to try harder. I'm just going to do the 7 steps to how to keep myself sexually pure. Don't throw a hymnal at me. That's why we don't have them. I'm kidding. It's not why we don't have them. Which things indeed have a show of wisdom. It looks good. That's what he's saying. It looks good. That's why I say people can't hear. Like when I talk about money, people say, oh, you don't believe in giving, right, Chris? Wrong. You don't believe in tithing. You don't believe in this. I just don't believe in using the curse to motivate God's people who are born again. I believe they're born again. They have a new nature. They got the Holy Ghost in them. They're putting the word. They see, yes, it doesn't merit anything from God. Jesus already did it. I believe it, so I respond. But see, when we put people back under mixture, we put them back under the law, we hurt them. And that's why people are frustrated and they're hurt. I'm talking about believers because they've been operating outside of who they are in Christ. And that's what this doctrine does. That's why these guys, Paul and John and New Testament writers, kept warning about this stuff, because it was constantly coming at the body. Because the adversary does not fear the world. He fears you and I. And he cannot come at us directly, so he's got to somehow get us under some type of false thinking. They have a show, which things indeed have a show of wisdom and will worship and humility and neglecting of the body. Neglecting of the body. Watch this. Not in any honor to the satisfying of the flesh. Look at the New American Standard there. This is really good in the New American Standard. Look at this. These are matters which have, to be sure, the appearance of wisdom in self-made religion. They have the appearance. Everybody say appearance. Look at that. Of wisdom. It really looks good. In self-made religion and self-abasement and severe treatment of the body. They look good. They look good. You know, how many people think, you know, we joke about it all the time. People think worldliness is whether you have a flat screen TV or not. Emerson and I joke about it all the time. That's what they think. They think worldliness is if you go to a football game. They think that's worldly. That's foolishness. God likes football too. I'm not going to tell you what Jen says. He likes the Browns. He definitely doesn't like the Browns. She does that to try to get on my nerves, but it doesn't work. It doesn't work. No. But with these things, it's self-made religion. That's worldliness. That's what worldliness is. It's you trying to exert your thing to try to somehow merit what Jesus has already done. See, and that's when you first start telling people that have been really lulled to death, and you really start telling them, they start understanding grace, then they think, well, then we don't have no part in it. That's wrong. That teaching is in the body of Christ too. It's wrong. If that's the case, there would nobody would ever be sick. Nobody would ever have any struggles. It would just be, da, 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 da. We're in a broken world, man. We're behind enemy lines. Amen? Okay. They have an appearance of wisdom in self-made religion and self-abasement and severe treatment of the body. Look at this. All these rules, he's saying, they are of no value. No value. Not a little value. No value against the indulgence, against fleshly indulgence. None. None. Isn't that something? Let's go to the book of 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. I'm going to give you these characteristics. Going to quit on time in Jesus' name. I started with this last week. 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. Beloved. In other words, so once again, he's talking to the church. He's talking to the church. We've talked about this before. In Matthew chapter 3, verse 17, the voice from heaven, the Father says, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. You get right in the next. It goes right into chapter 4, verse 1. You go down about verses 3 or 4. Immediately when Satan tempts Jesus, notice what he says. He said, if you're the Son of God, he deletes the word beloved, because if Satan can get you to doubt God's love for you, he's got you. That's why we need to major on God's love for us, not our love for God. That's why we talk about it all the time. You say, well, I got it. Don't you have it, Chris? No, I don't. I'm constantly seeing where I don't have a revelation of how much he loves me. I get glimpses of it. It's so powerful. I got you on this one, Chris. The Bible says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, fear and trembling. See, the fear of the Lord. See, you hear people say we need to preach on the fear of the Lord. You ever heard that? What is the fear of the Lord? We've talked about that before. But I want to take it a little bit different angle today. In fact, let's go to that verse. We'll come right back here. The fear of the Lord. Are you ready? Philippians chapter 2, verse 12. If the fear of the Lord was terror of God, why when, like, say, the angel appears to Zacharias, when the angel appears to Mary, Luke chapter 1, all the time, the first thing they say is, fear not. You ever notice that? If it was terror, if it was like backing away from God, why was the angel always saying, fear not? You can't approach somebody you're afraid of. You won't approach somebody you're afraid of. But look at this. Wherefore, my beloved. There he goes, beloved. Isn't that interesting? This verse even has that in there. Because he wants you to understand that God loves you. Well, what does this mean then, Chris? You have always obeyed, not in my presence only, but now much more in my absence. Work out, not for. Not for. Work out, not for. Doesn't say work for your own salvation. It says work out your own salvation. You've already got it. Work it out. Watch it. With fear and trembling. The next verse says, for God's working in you both to will and to do of his purpose, now, of his own good pleasure. Back up to verse 12. I want you to see this. Well, what about this? Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. What does it mean? Let me tell you what it means. When you get a revelation of how much God loves you, it's scary. It's so awesome. It's hard to take. That's what he's talking about. Isn't that something? But we're thinking, well, I'll tell you what, God's just about had it with me. No, you're basing it on people. That's how people are. That's not how God is. See, and you can't visit this stuff and get a revelation of it. You got to live in it. You got to lay in bed at night and think about, Lord, just the revelation of God's love for me. Let that increase the breadth, the length, the depth, and height. That's the only way God's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that you ask or think is when you get a revelation of the breadth, the length, the depth of God's love for you. Look at that. When you get a revelation, it's scary, it's so good. It's scary, it's so good. God loves me. God loves you. But you got to make it personal. Open your mouth. Say, God loves me. I said it earlier, with the heart you believe into righteousness. With the mouth you release it. You begin to declare, I'm the disciple whom Jesus loves. God loves me. God loves me. That's it. What shall we say to these things? All the things that come against us. If God's for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not also with Jesus freely give me everything I could ever need or ever want? But see, we still think it's out there. See, mixture's not just the obvious law and grace. Mixture's mixing the love of God with the effort of the world. That's heavy. That's good. Go back to 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. We're doing good on time. We're doing good on time. I got to get to those 13 things. We're going to reveal to you the Antichrist, who he is. Or maybe it's a she. What's that guy that always did that? Not kidding. All right. Beloved, believe not. Last week we talked about that. Every spirit, but try the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets are going out in the world. We talked about the importance. Let me say some things. The spirit of Antichrist, I said this many times, is not the spirit of anti-God. It's actually pro-God, but Antichrist. We got to repeat that. The spirit of Antichrist, I'm going to give you 13 characteristics when we go down here, of Antichrist operates in the pulpit and not outside the pulpit. The spirit of Antichrist claims loyalty to Jesus and tells you, oh yeah, Jesus loves you, this I know, but if you don't do this, God's ticked at you. You never know what side of the bed the Lord may get up on. No, that's your husband or wife. Just they look at each other. I'm just kidding. Don't look at each other. That's not a good time. But the spirit of Antichrist, watch this. So, and we talked about this. It denies the work of Jesus. I wrote some things down the Lord gave me this morning. The spirit of Antichrist zaps the excitement out of God's word because it removes Jesus. If you're born again and you're not excited about God's word, don't be condemned. But I will tell you, you don't understand his intense love for you. What was he saying to me yesterday when we were talking? He goes, man, I can see your excitement. And Jen's sitting right next to me. He said, yep, he's always like this too. Because this is the most exciting life. Jesus loves me. Take that, devil. He loves me. God carries his picture in my wallet. He's got a 3x5 of me on the mantle in heaven. Amen. God loves you, man. But you can't comprehend that with this brain. It takes the mind of Christ to comprehend the intensity. See, that's why the Bible, we said it last week, Galatians 5:6, faith works by love, not faith works by my love. Faith works by love. He is love. Faith works if you understand love. I told you last week out of 1 Corinthians 13:13, and now abides faith, hope, and charity, or God's kind of love. The greatest is love. Because faith and hope cannot produce love, but the love of God will produce faith and will produce hope. Get your hopes up as you meditate on the love of God. As you meditate on the love of God, get your hopes sky high. Why do I think that God wants to shake the world from an alfalfa field in West Central Ohio? Why do I think that? I don't know in the natural, but it's in me. I can't figure it out. The more I meditate on the love of God, every person, you were created for a purpose. You're not created to just exist and go to work and get up and someday retire and go on a vacation or two and then die. That's not God's plan. God wants to use you to shake the world. That's why retirement's never a concept in the mind of a world changer. You're a world changer. You're a world changer. Christ lives in you, the hope of glory. But see, the spirit of Antichrist will cause you to focus on that and then cause you to focus on you. It ain't about you. It's about who's in you. That's why he says you have this treasure in cheap clay pottery. Why? So the excellency of the power can be known to be of God and not of Chris. Woo! Man, I'm having fun. The spirit of Antichrist zaps the excitement out of God's word. How does it do that? It removes Jesus. And without Jesus, it's not life keeping you. It's just laws that you have to keep. That's what it does. It removes Jesus. That's why I said spirit of Antichrist is pro-God, anti-Christ. Very subtle. And it makes it about what you're doing. That's why we talk about speaking the word. It's important to speak the word. But let me tell you something. I used to speak the word. I used to walk the floor and speak the word. I'm the head, not the tail. I'm blessed coming in and going out. I'm blessed in the city, blessed in the country. I'm all these things because that's what they told me to do. And then one day I read, if I hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord my God to observe and to do all that he commands me, then these blessings come on me. Not just my 30 times of saying it. Are you hearing? And then one day I saw in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5, bring every thought in captivity to the obedience, not of Chris, but of Christ. I thought, oh yeah, that sounds like world overcoming faith. Faith in who? In his obedience, not mine. Hear the difference? But see, the Antichrist spirit makes it about his obedience, yeah, somewhere. And then your obedience is real important. Our obedience is simply a response to what he's done. See, there's godly obedience. The word obedience in Romans chapter 6 simply means hearing under. It means to hear under the frequency of the new covenant. Woo! Hallelujah. Now that's obedience. That's responding to what Christ has done. Spirit of Antichrist removes the excitement of God's word because it removes Jesus. The whole world is being duped by a spirit of Antichrist. Not a man, but works through a man. These are things I wrote down this morning. Spirit of Antichrist draws you away from the life of God in your born-again spirit. It draws you away from the life of God in your born-again spirit. See, this is what I said earlier in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. It says, he's blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Everyone. That doesn't mean they're just somewhere in the spirit realm and you can't access them in the natural. That just means that that's the origin. So if you're not operating from your spirit, let me show you these verses out of Romans chapter 10, Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, watch this. Verse 10, we'll just start with verse 10. Oh, I'm getting excited. I feel the Holy Ghost. I feel him in my spirit. Oh, we don't live by feelings, brother. I agree with that. Not external, but there's a knowing. There's a knowing that God's saying, go here. Romans chapter 8, verse 10, and if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin. In other words, in God's eyes, he's not even looking at your body stuff. At your actions. Or he's saying, I've declared that vehicle is rendered dead in my eyes as far as meriting any type of righteousness. But here's what I'm after. But the Spirit, horrible translation. That should be a little less there. Pneuma in Greek. It's talking about your born-again spirit. The Spirit is life because of righteousness. God's infused you with life. That's why Paul said in Romans 1:9, I thank God whom I serve with my spirit. In other words, that's my power source. That's where the excitement lies. You say, well, I'm depressed right now. That's because you're going by the external stuff and you don't understand who you are in Christ. Whew! And the Spirit is life, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Next verse. But if the Spirit of Him that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, He that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken or make alive. Does God care about your physical body? Absolutely, yes. The word quicken means make alive. Your mortal body. The word mortal means death, doom, that someday you'll shed this body. But He'll quicken it. He'll empower it. He'll heal it. He'll let the... But it comes from who you are in the Spirit.
That's it.
See, if you don't understand spirit, soul, and body, see, the spirit of Antichrist comes against that. Where you're a new creature at is a spiritual reality. You may be depressed now, but I can guarantee you, your spirit, if you're born again, is doing flip-flops. It is rejoicing. It is full of the peace of God. You know why we have fear? Because we look outside instead of inside through the Word of God. That's why He says God hasn't given you the spirit of fear. Fear is a spirit, but of power and of love and of a sound mind.
Amen.
Watch this. He shall quicken your mortal bodies by His Spirit. Notice how He quickens or makes alive your mortal bodies. By His Spirit that dwells in you. By His Spirit. He talks about in 1 Thessalonians 5:23, it's spirit, soul, and body. Not body, soul, and spirit. That's legalism. That's Antichrist spirit. Body first. The Bible says in Galatians 5, walk in the Spirit and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. The church says, hey, don't fulfill the lust of the flesh and you'll be walking in the Spirit. That's dyslexic. You're seeing it backwards. If you walk according to who you are in the Spirit, it's automatic. You don't fulfill the lust of the flesh. But if you're trying to get it together on the outside, you're a mess. And you're frustrated. And we all got varying degrees of that. I'm coming out of it just like you are. I see many times. But I'm realizing that now I know why He calls it the good fight of faith. Not for faith, but of faith. It's a fight to believe how good He is. That's why I say you got to live it. God loves you if you don't do any of it. God loves you if you watch Roadrunner all day, but when you go to pray for people and all that comes out is... He still loves you. But the Spirit of the man, she shall quicken your mortal bodies by the flesh's ability. No, by His Spirit that dwells in you. Next verse. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to live after the flesh. In other words, you don't have to try to appropriate any of the goodness of God through your own ability. Next verse. This is what I'm after. Watch this. For if you live after the flesh or self's ability, if you live after in your own strength, watch this. It says, ye shall die. In the Greek, it's in the present tense. It's literally saying you are dying. You're not experiencing the life of God. You're born again, but you're not experiencing the life of God. Depression is a form of death. Sickness is a form of death. It says, but if you through, this is what I'm after. But if you through the flesh, your own ability, do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. Thank you, Roger. Well, one person shaking their head no. Everyone else is, yeah, amen, brother, that's good. I'm teasing. And if it's you through the Spirit man, through who you are in Christ, that's how you mortify the deeds of the body. Spirit of Antichrist draws you away from the life of God in you, or it's in your born-again spirit. This is why sometimes prayers seem like they're unanswered, because it flows from the Spirit out. Watch this. Prayer, what is prayer? Prayer is releasing the life of God, or the one that God has. Oh, boy, I got to read my own writing. Releasing the connection. That's it. I write in tongues. Prayer, I need the interpretation. Prayer is releasing the connection one has with God through Christ, which is a spiritual reality. Prayer is releasing the connection that one has to God through Christ, which is in the Spirit. Are you hearing? That's where it comes from. That's the source. That's the power plant. It comes from the inside out, not the outside in. But see, religion causes you to focus on your performance instead of what Jesus did. And so you're always looking out here. Have I kept the rules? Have I confessed the word enough? Have I done all these things? Have I had my... See, I encourage a devotional time. But I've told you many times, a devotional time is not about completing something. The devotional time is about connecting to a completed work. Can you hear the difference? My, this is good stuff. Praise God Almighty. All right, back to 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. Well, now, stay right there. I want to show you one thing. Verse 16, jump down to verse 16. I'll show you this real quick, and then we'll come back to 1 John 4. Look at verse 16. It says, His Spirit bears witness with my spirit, in verse 16. His Spirit bears witness. The Spirit itself, I don't like itself, himself, New King James. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit. The Holy Spirit bears witness with my spirit that we are the children of God. So the Holy Spirit bears witness, not with my mind, not with my flesh, but with my spirit. You hear the difference? Now, watch this. I thought, what is this bearing witness all about? And I thought, and I said, the Lord said, read it in context. So back up to verse 14. This is what I'm after. Watch this. Verse 14. For as many as are led. He's talking about leading. He's talking about leading. Remember verse 16. We'll get to it here. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. You can't be led by the Spirit of God if you're not born again. If any man has not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. It says in a preceding verse. Next verse. Now this is right before 16. Remember, His Spirit bears witness with my spirit that I'm a child of God. What does that have to do? For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. Notice it says again. When did we have it before? When we were not born again. When we were basing our relationship with God. Well, I don't know. I just did this. I hope the man upstairs is happy with what I did. Isn't that how we relate to God? That's how the world relates. That's how everybody relates. They have this mindset. I listen to people and I go, we're preaching karma. If my good outweighs my bad, then somehow I'm in. That's Hinduism. New age. I don't care how much good you have, if you'll never be enough. There was only one who was enough. That's why it says you're complete in Christ, not complete in Chris. It's in Christ. Yes, hallelujah. That's why it's good news. I get what Jesus deserves. He took all the bad I deserve, so I get all the good He deserves. Man, that's a grand slam. Amen. Hallelujah. So what? You can't be miserable if you know this. I don't know. You know, if you don't like me, He does. He loves me. He thinks I'm cool. He likes to hang out with me. That's why He says, I'll never leave you nor forsake you, no matter how bad your breath is. He loves me. He loves you. Amen. Oh, we got to focus on this. We got to meditate on this. That's what John was saying. The separation of grace and law is a separation of love and fear. The opposite of love is not fear. It's law, which produces fear. It's the spirit of Antichrist. It's Antichrist, but pro-God. He says, you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. The Amplified Bible says, you have not received the slavish spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received, I have received. The spirit of adoption. Can we say the correct Greek word? The spirit of sonship. I am a son of God. He calls me child. I'm His son. I'm His son. I have the same acceptance that the Son, Jesus, has Himself because of the work of Jesus. My, oh my. Now, does that make you want to go out and get drunk? Or does that make you want to praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Who said drunk? I'm kidding. No one did. That was a joke. That makes me want to praise the Lord. I get so tired of legalism. I do. My brother's thing, we set up our church booth last night for Striper. And then I know Steve was selling some beer and stuff there and all that stuff. And someone was saying, oh, da-da-da-da, all that kind of stuff. I said, I joke with people. I said, well, we're selling beer right out of our church booth. I'm kidding. Don't get uptight. God's not worked up about stuff. I hate religion. I hate it. I hate it. When Robert Sweet told me that what that preacher said to him, who was later busted for drugs or something like that, when he told me what that guy said to him, I didn't even know that guy, but I wanted to go back in time and choke him. Because he said devastated him. You know how many times People that are coming to the Lord. I remember when I first got saved and we were playing rock music and I thought, wow. And we started switching to Christian music and I'll never forget. I thought we were doing good, man. We were doing some Christian songs, a couple of them, but we're still doing Judas Priest and Crocus and bands like that. And I thought, man, we're really making progress. And I went to work one day and I ran into a Pharisee and he was like saying, you can't straddle the fence. You either got to be for God or against him. Really? Really? Here I am, a baby. Christian, will we? And I'm riding home with the guy that sang in the band. And he said, I wouldn't let what Joe Blow, not his real name, said. I wouldn't worry about that. And that's the only thing I think that rescued. I was devastated. Because this guy's like a church-going man, a Christian man, and he's sitting there condemning me. And I actually thought we were doing good. I thought we were making progress. I didn't know anything. Golly, when will we ever get it that God loves people? You know the prostitutes and the harlots hung out with Jesus? You know the ones he had a problem with? Religion. It's no different today. It's the spirit of Antichrist that thinks it's about your rule-keeping instead of what Jesus did. Amen. And has no power against the indulgence of the flesh. None of these things change anything. They only appear. They have a show, a facade of wisdom in will worship and humility and neglecting of the body. But they have no power against fleshly indulgences. None. All right. So I haven't received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but I have received the spirit of sonship whereby my heart cries, Daddy, God, Abba, Father. Next verse, His spirit bears witness with my spirit. The spirit himself bears witness with my spirit. What does that witnessing do? That God no longer leads through fear like it was under the old covenant. God's now leading through a spirit of sonship. Whew. He's talking about leadership. His spirit bears witness. It has to do with the leadership of the Holy Ghost. It's no longer a fear, spirit of fear and bondage and incarceration. It's not like that anymore. It's now a leadership of love. The love of God compels me, constrains me, it says in 2 Corinthians 5:14. Quick back to 1 John. Oh, golly, time screamed by. I'm going to have to fly through these. 1 John chapter 4, we're not going there. I'm just going to give them to you because I have to. Or I'll turn into a pumpkin. No, I'm kidding. A pumpkin. Jen always corrects me. I say pumpkin. So I just like to torment her. And I'll find these words that I butcher. See, you have to understand how I was raised. My dad. You've heard this one. You call our house. It's not like this anymore. I think we should leave it up because I thought it was awesome. My dad's on there. He says, you have reached the Bar Horse Reservation. So, you know, cut me some slack, all right? You could stop at our reservation sometime. Let me give you these quick and I'll give you the references. All ready? 1 John chapter 2, verse 18. The early Christians had heard that Antichrist was coming. I may go through these sometime, maybe next week, maybe not, because I want to move on down. 1 John chapter, that's 1 John 2:18. 1 John 2:18 again. Even now there are many Antichrists. Even now, first century. Even now, there's many antichrists. Okay? First, same verse, 1 John chapter 2, verse 18. This is evidence. I probably will spend some time on this and start with it because I'm going to end here in a minute. Even now, watch this. Or this is evidence that the last time has come. 1 John chapter 2, that's verse 18. Those three things. The early Christians had heard that antichrist was coming. Even now, there are many antichrists. This is evidence that the last time has come. 1 John chapter 2, verse 19 says, these antichrists went out from among us. These antichrists went out from among us. I'm going to stop. I'm disciplining myself. We'll do all these. We're going to go down because this is not doing it justice. I got to talk about this. We got to break it down because I want to go to the verses too. You need to see this. Antichrist is not some guy rising up in the Middle East. He's not some guy from Romania or Russia or China. Antichrist is right behind many pulpits in America and around the world today because he's preaching God, but he's removing Christ by saying it's about what Jesus did and that you better get it together too. If I could get it together in my own strength, then I don't need Jesus. It's that simple. And see, the Bible says, as you have received Christ Jesus, the Lord, so walk in him, Colossians 2:6. In other words, I received him by trusting in him. He says, keep that same trust in him, right? The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12 that he is the author and the finisher of our faith. Man's religion says he's the author, but you got to finish it. Hear the difference? You can't finish it. So I'm going to get down into these 13 characteristics, and they get really, really good. And the Bible says, I'm going to just tell you this one. I'll leave you with this one. It says, don't bid him Godspeed. What does that mean? It's a good question. But how many, I see Christians all around, we're bidding at Godspeed. My wife and I will close with this, I think. I've got to keep that in there. My wife and I, we were associated with a group, and they're preaching universalism. They're preaching New Age doctrine. And I know the difference. I do know the difference. And the Lord said, do not bid them Godspeed. Do not bid them Godspeed. If you do, you're a partaker of their evil deeds. What are their evil deeds? Are they out killing cats and all that stuff? No. It's nothing to do with that. The evil deed is preaching doctrine that confuses the body of Christ. That's very evil. It doesn't mean they're intentional. I believe people are sincere. I tell people all the time, I believe Muslim terrorists are sincere. You've got to be sincere to blow yourself up. Or just an extreme idiot, one of the two. Amen? That's deception. So sincerity. The people have a zeal for God, but it's not according to righteousness. They go about to establish their own righteousness. And many times that righteousness is just what we think we know. We establish our own system in our thinking. Amen. I'm going to stop. Praise God. I have to. Say, are you blessed?
Yes.
We're going to get in the rest of these. These are so good. You'll see them. I have a goal to get all the way through 1 John chapter 4 because it is awesome. The Bible says we love him. Literally, we love because he first loved us. That's all in that chapter. It says perfect love casts out fear. Whose love is perfect? Your love for God or his love for you? I would have to go with answer B also. That's what casts out fear. Who likes fear? I hate fear. It's torturous. Amen. If anybody here is not born again, I want to give you the opportunity to accept Jesus today. Is anybody here not born again? Or you want to get born again? That's a joke. You can't do that. Well, maybe you lost your salvation because you stubbed your toe. Wrong. God's goodness is far greater than your inconsistencies. Now that's good news.
Amen.
If it wasn't, we'd all be up the creek without a paddle, without a canoe, without a life jacket, and real close and right by that waterfall. Amen. Amen. If this is all based on his goodness. And seeing the victory that overcomes the world is my faith. Faith in what? In his goodness. Not in Chris's goodness, in his goodness. That's victory. I love it. God is so good. God so loves you. He's so excited about you. If anybody's not born again or anybody wants to receive the baptism in the Holy Spirit or anybody needs prayer for healing because we are going to exit this building. Amen. Pray for us. We will be back here next Sunday. We will be, but Jen and I are going to Andrew Womack's Ministers Conference this week and we're excited about it. Amen.
Amen.
I'll tell you this story. Ramin, my friend from Iran, and he was doing some translating some stuff from English to Farsi. And he was translating some of our American preachers. And Ramin is an awesome man of God. He's going to be there. And he told me, he said, I can no longer translate what he calls some of these American nonsense preachers that are preaching nonsense. And he says, they're putting these people back under law. It's just as bad over there too. Because these Iranians, they get born again, they come into churches, and then they're taught it's about the laws you keep instead of who's keeping you. They go and put them right back under law. So Ramin's, this is his goal. He's hoping to meet with Andrew. I got him hooked up with Cecil. He's got a PowerPoint presentation. Andrew, I've heard him share that he's got a vision to have a station with all New Covenant preachers on. And he wants to fund it. I've heard him say that. So hopefully that's in things that are going to happen. And wouldn't it be awesome if you could go and you could flip on grace preachers and I have to get to another one who's condemning you. And can you imagine you just get born again and all of a sudden you're going through and you're listening, wow, that was really good. That, and then all of a sudden you get down, wow, maybe it isn't such good news after all. Isn't that powerful? And so Ramin's got, so pray about these things. Because I really believe these are the types of things that God wants to do. A lot of these Iranians, they escape, and if you go look on your map, they go right into Turkey, and that's where he was for a couple years. He wants to see a Bible college established in Turkey, and he got all kinds of crusades, all kinds of ideas. This is what God wants us to do. You know, we're bigger than an alfalfa field. It has nothing to do with the number of people in the seats, although the more the better. Amen? For the right reason. Not just to be big, to be big. To touch the world. Come on, guys. 50, 60 years from now, a lot of us will be gone. Come on, think about that. Do you ever think about that? We have this ability to think that, well, it happens to other people. It'll never happen to me. You're going to cross over. I want to hear these words, well done, good and faithful servant. Now, I'm not saved by works, but there is something. When I use what he's given me, and that's why I say God's called you to touch the world, not just to exist, to take up space and air and food. God's called you to touch the world. Amen. These people all over the world are crying out for what you have. I noticed it yesterday in my conversations. People are crying and they can't even see they're crying. They can't understand why they're frustrated. I'm saying because you don't know how much Jesus loves you. You're not even on that path. You keep going, well, yeah, I talked to one guy that it used to be. I am done, by the way. I talked to one guy, the timer's off, that used to be, if you can turn that off, that would be great. Thank you, Michael.